beautiful day. It may be a little warm, but just glad to see that each one of you decided that you wanted to be in the Lord's house today. And God will be here, and He will meet with us, and we can feel His presence. And we're thankful for each one of you that has come, and we're especially thankful for our visitors, Pete and Nancy Hicks. And Brother Hicks is a minister also, and he has pastored, what was the last church he pastored in?
Webster Chapel.
Okay, and he told me not long ago that they were going to come and visit, and it kind of shocked me when he came in. I'm sure glad he did. And then, Ed, I don't know about you and Beth and Teddy, you get me confused now, because I had you placed over on this side, and then you come in today and you sit over here. But that's good. You know, you can sit anywhere you want to, but we're just glad that each one of you are here. And I want you to pray for the service today. I told some of them, you know, we've got a website, and I really am thankful for the website that Joy and Jerry is working on. And got on, so you can go on the website and see every one of the services. And the only problem is when I listen to it, I see all my mistakes. And I told them I got some things I want to try to get a hold of. I got where I talk too fast. And talk so fast sometimes, I don't know if you really understand what I'm saying. And I steal from time to time. I don't want God to take this away from me. But from the time that God called me to preach until today, I still get excited. When I get excited, I get a little loud sometimes. And I'm going to try to get a hold of some of this, but I'm not going to cut it out. Because I remember I made a mistake one time when I was first called to preach. And every time I stood up to preach, I'd cry. And that was every time. And I prayed and asked God. I said, God, if I'm going to preach, you're going to have to take my crying away. In fact, some of them got to where they called me the weeping prophet. And so God took it away. You know, and so now then I wish God would just give me the tears again like he did once before. But so I won't ever pray for God to take anything away. But and I know that there's been times that I just didn't feel like I could ever get through a preaching service. And God has never failed to help me. And I know that I am, as Joy puts in the bulletin, I am a nobody trying to tell everybody about somebody who can save anybody. Mm-hmm. And that's what I am. I am a nobody. I am nothing apart from God. Everything I have is because of what God has given me and helped me to do. Without Him, I could do nothing. But we're certainly glad that you're here and that you will add to the service. And I know that any time that any of you would like to come up and sing in the choir, you're welcome. And we're trying to learn a few new ones so you won't have to listen to the same things all the time. But you are the church, and we're thankful for each and every one of you. And just pray that we have come here for one purpose, and one purpose alone is that we might meet with the Lord here, go away knowing that we have met God in the service. Sad to come to church, and I hope you don't ever do this. I'm going to try to do something to make you glad you came to church. But it's sad to come to church and go home and don't even know that you've ever been to church. You don't even know that you've met God. And it's just something wrong. I think you should enjoy. I hope you enjoy coming to church. You know, I've never lost it. I used to wouldn't go to Sunday school. I wouldn't go to church. And after God saved me, it didn't take but one Sunday till He changed my mind. And ever since then, I have always loved to be in the house of God on Sunday. And I'm thankful for that, and I pray that I don't ever lose that desire to serve Him. We had a good Sunday school lesson, the Sunday school class this morning, and we missed you and invite you to come and be with us on Sunday morning for our Sunday school lesson. And I think you might get something. It's a good time of fellowship, and somebody always fix the coffee before you get here, and it's ready for you to drink if you drink coffee. But thank you for being here, and may God bless you for coming. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, this morning we know that we are always in need, and apart from you, Lord, there's nothing that we can do. And since we started the series on the message of the second coming of Christ, oh Lord, there's many times that we just feel like we need your knowledge and your word, that you would come into our life and into our mind and heart and help us to be able to relate to the congregation that which we feel like and see what we see in the Scripture. And realize that the coming of Christ is the next great event that's coming on the earth when God's going to come back and He's going to take His children in the rapture back into heaven to be with Him forever and ever and ever. Oh God, and then there's some horrible things that's coming upon this world that I know that none of us wants to go through. So I pray, oh Lord, today that You would touch the hearts of these that have come, that You would speak to them, and whatever their need might be, Lord, let them know that You can meet that need. And we just pray that we can leave here today saying that it has been good to be in the house of the Lord, because we feel like that we have met with Him to worship Him. And for all that's done and accomplished, we'll thank and praise You. In the name of Jesus Christ, we do ask. Amen.
Amen. All right, let's join together in worship and start off with our first song in the red hymnal 454. Open my eyes that I may see. We'll sing all three verses.
Thank you.
6. As we sing Precious Name, we will sing the first, second, and last stanzas today. 536. Consider that and remember that in your prayers if you cannot donate. Please pray for the workers as well. And in the end, at the bottom there, if you know of somebody we can visit with in the community, please let us know by filling out some of that information there and getting it to either Alan, JW, or myself. We'll be glad to go out and visit with the community because we're trying to reach out to this community here with our little church. So if you know somebody that we can visit with, please let us know. All right, do we have any other announcements today before we have our joys and concerns and prayer? All right, we'll move into our time of prayer. We have a lot of concerns that are listed in the bulletin, and I have some here to mention, but I will ask first, does anybody have any concerns or joys to share today?
we say it's good to be in the house of the Lord.
Amen. It's always a good time to come to fellowship and worship together. And I know I'm very thankful for the air conditioning. I don't know about y'all, but it's been a scorcher out there this past week. So let's thank God for the invention of the air conditioning this week.
Well, we need to remember Judy today.
Yes.
There she's got a broken hand with her uncle and that massive stroke.
Yes.
I'd like for us to think about Brian Hood. He's the human resource manager at Sears, a young man. And he has so much blockage in his heart that he needs to stand it.
You said maybe Brian Hood? Okay. And as Sue said, Judy is not with us today because her uncle, Wayne Dodd, had a massive stroke yesterday. So she is down in Birmingham with family. And so please let's remember Wayne Dodd and Judy's family in our prayers. And
Margie
also.
Margie Gann, her family. Margie Gann's family.
Margie Gann. Is that G-A-N or?
G-A-N.
Gant. Also, we need to remember two families, the Hubble family and the Sloan family. Jerry, do you want to mention
it's
about that?
McCord Communications. Those two guys were killed Thursday. A crane backed into the guy wire and pulled the tower down. They died. So just remember them.
Yeah, that two people in those families worked with McCord Communication, and a crane hit one of the towers they were working on at Fort McClellan, and the tower came down, and so did they, and they were killed. So we need to remember the Sloan and Hubble family. Also, the concerns that were listed last week, Lynn Hathcock and Louise Longshore.
Thanks for the prayers. She prayed for Louise. She's good a lot better, but she's got a place in the hospital.
Okay. And also, a lady I work with, her grandmother is in her last days, so please just pray for comfort for that family. The name is Elsie Rogers.
Well, and remember the Gann family, that the girl, Margie Gann, passed away yesterday, and the funeral will be Monday afternoon, 2 o'clock.
We don't know whose house burned last night, but whoever it is, we need to remember them. They'll go by name.
House around here?
Yeah.
On the circle.
So let's remember the people that family have lost their house to a fire down here close to the river. Again, this isn't just a time of concern. If anybody has any joys or anything to mention, please feel free to do that as well.
I can't shut up, but my nephew is doing so well, and he'll have a PET scan in a few weeks. Right now, they're trying to build his iron back up and see if his cancer is complete. My sister is doing so much better.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Amen. All right. If there are no others, let's take just a moment of silent prayer to ourselves. And I'll close us out with prayer as we remember all these concerns and, that have been mentioned today. Heavenly Father, as we have gathered in your house this morning, Father, first of all, we would like to thank you for bringing us back safely again to worship you today. And we pray that everything that we do in this service today may be pleasing in your sight. And just open our hearts and minds as we prepare to enter into our time of hearing the message that you've laid upon Alan's heart to share with us this morning, I pray that you would just fill him with your Holy Spirit and let every word that comes out of his mouth be inspired by you. Father, also, as we have come today, we thank you for our freedom to be able to come here and worship you. We thank you for being able to worship in a cool building this morning. And the summertime heat has really cranked up out there. But we thank you for just blessing us with this opportunity to be able to come into your house today. Father, there are many concerns that have been mentioned today. There are so many families that are hurting right now in so many different ways. Father, you know every concern that has been mentioned. And I lift each and every family and each and every name that has been lifted up today before our congregation. I pray that it is lifted up to you. Father, you know the best thing in every situation. Father, we may not understand some situations, why they happen the way they do, but just we know that you're in control fully and that your way is the best way, even though we might not understand it at times. Father, I just pray for those that are hurting with sickness and those that have had an experienced death in their family, those that have lost their house, their possessions, and those fighting battles in so many different ways, sickness, financial battles, you know, just any kind of way. Father, you know every concern, like I said. I pray that you would just comfort and guide those that are hurting today. And as we have gathered here today, may you open our hearts and minds and to hear what you have to say to us through our songs that we sing and through our worship and through our message that we will be hearing later on. Father, I pray that again, you just be with us as we continue to worship you the best way we know how. And we will be eternally grateful and give you the praise and glorify your name that you're much deserving of. I pray all these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. All right, our choir is going to sing today our anthem, "The Next Time He Comes."
Our flow, our man to come.
An update. He said he's not listening today, but he wants to make sure everybody's awake.
Chapter 24, verse 26, he says, "But of that day and hour knoweth no man, No, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only. Man, foolish man that he is, has made attempts at setting exact days and times. However, even though we can't set an exact date for his return, we can know the approximate time or the nearness of his coming. 1 Thessalonians 5, verses 1 through 6. 1 through 2 says, but of the times and the seasons, brethren, you have no need that I write unto you. For yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night, that is, unannounced. For when they shall say peace and safety, then sudden destruction cometh on them as travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. Now this applies to unbelievers. His coming will come as a surprise to the world, the unbelievers, but not true of the believers. 1 Thessalonians 5, verses 4 and 6. But you, brethren, talking about the believers, are not in darkness, that that day should overtake you as a thief. Ye are the children of light, and the children of the day. We are not of the night or darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as others, but let us watch and be sober. Now this teaching is clear, that while we cannot know the day nor the hour, we are to look for the signs of the approximate time of his return. When certain signs, according to Jesus, appear, then we are to know that day is near. Luke 21:38 says, and when these things begin to come to pass, then look up and lift your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh. It is not wrong to be interested in the Lord's return, so his disciples asked him, tell us when and what signs that we are to look for. Then Jesus gave the one sign. But as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. For it was in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day that Noah entered into the ark, and they knew not until the flood came and took them all away. So shall the coming of the Son of Man be. Now friends, you know, back in that day, he's talking about marrying and giving in marriage, and basically what he's telling us here is, life is going to be going on as usual when the Lord comes back. Not everybody's going to be looking for him, but we as believers should know when he's near and be ready for him at his coming. So we know that this is going to take place, eating and drinking. Now listen, have any of you questioned whether we are really taking up a lot of our life today eating and drinking? How many of you, when you get up for breakfast, is saying, what are we having for lunch? You know, we're just looking forward to eating and drinking. And I guess we're becoming a nation of gluttons, I guess. I don't know. We eat so much. We don't really eat because we need it. We eat because it's lunch and it's breakfast and it's dinner. I still would call it supper. I was brought up saying supper, not dinner. And I know every time we ever use the word supper, one of our grandkids will correct us and say, it's not supper, it's dinner. Well, it's been supper all my life just about it, and it's hard for me to change it into dinner because it's the same meal, same food. And so I still call it supper sometimes today, but that may not be correct. But Jesus said, if you want an answer to your question, then study the conditions before the flood, and when the conditions are repeated, then know that it is near, at your very door. The social and economic conditions are found in Genesis chapter 4. And we find 8 specific things that are mentioned. And some of these are first mentioned. First time these things are mentioned, and any time is the first mention of anything, it's very, very important that we take notice of it. One of the 8 things is religious apostasy. Well, we got into that last week, the week before, when we was talking about Cain and Abel. One was a modernist. He was just one that didn't believe in the fundamentals of the Bible. But at least he didn't know that God had given a command that they would bring an offering unto God. And he brought the best he had in the field, but he didn't believe in the blood, the shedding of the blood, the atoning of the blood. And so Cain killed his brother Abel because God accepted Abel's offering because it was a little lamb that he didn't have to work for, and it was free, and he didn't have to labor any at all. It was a gift of God. And he offered what God had demanded, and God accepted, and Abel got mad and jealous of his brother and killed his brother Abel. And so several things happened to Cain. But that's religious apostasy is the first thing. The second thing is travel. Travel is mentioned for the first time. And then we have city building. We have agricultural advances. We have music. We have the use of heavy metals mentioned, and then we have violence and crime. Now, we have discussed the conflict between Cain and Abel, Cain religious, but conscious of his use towards God. The birth of Christ, his eternal deity, his substitutionary death, redemption by blood, his bodily resurrection, and his literal coming again. Our modernist friends, so-called, are gracious to say it is all right if you want to believe this, but it makes no difference. I mean, they don't object to you believing it, but they say it don't make any difference. But now, what has the shedding of a blood by a man 2,000 years ago, how can that have anything to do with you today and your salvation? Like, the blood of a man that many years ago, you can believe it if you want to, but it don't really matter whether you believe it or not. But I want to tell you, it does matter. It does depend upon what you believe. What you believe, it has a lot to do with God saving you. He that believeth the Father, and he that believeth the Son, he said, if you believe the Son, you believe in me. If you've seen me, you have seen the Father, Jesus Christ said. And so he that liveth and believeth in me shall never perish. Do you believe this? Is what he asked the two sisters. And they said, yes, Lord, we believe. Thou art the Christ, the Son of God. And so, friends, it does matter what we believe and what we think of. But the moderns don't believe in these things. They say there's no need to believe in all these things. It has no bearing upon you, but you can do it if you want to. But there is a separation going on from this apostate compromising system and a calling out of a small company to a place without the camp with the Christ of the Scriptures. You know, Jesus was always outside the camp. He was cast outside, and people didn't really have a whole lot to do with him at times. And he had to be out there by himself. But there's a group, and God is calling out right now. And there's a group of people today that's calling us out of this false teaching and this false preaching and these false churches and these sects and everything else. They're being called out. God is still calling out a small group, and they're coming out from this. And even though it may be going out here outside the gates and outside the place and just in finding Christ there alone, at least we'll be out there where he wants us to be. And that's what we need to be today. But friends, I think today that there is a calling out. And I believe that people are kind of getting back, some people are getting back to the fundamentals of the Bible. And that is what I think is great. Now we find another significant sign of the last days in Genesis chapter 4, verse 16. And Cain went out from the presence of the Lord and dwelt in the land of Nod on the east side of Eden. Now Nod means literally the land of wandering, and it implies a traveling from place to place. Tradition is that Cain traveled to India, China, and other remote lands, and represented a far distance. This being the first mention of travel in the Bible gathers great significance in the light of the words of Jesus. With this, Daniel the prophet agrees when speaking of the end time. He said, the Lord revealed to him the course of the age, the times of the Gentiles, and what would happen in the end time. You know, when you look at the book of Daniel, and he talks about it and tells us the first four world kingdoms that would come into existence, and they came into existence in the exact order that he said. And when he said, the first one was the great Babylonian world kingdom, one of the greatest kingdoms that ever existed. And Nebuchadnezzar was one of the greatest kings that ever existed. And then the Medes and the Persians came in, and they destroyed Babylon. And then they reigned for a while. And then you had Alexander the Great and the Greeks that came in. And they, and in the very order, and the Roman Empire was last. And so these are the world kingdoms that we have had. And that will be all the world kingdoms until one called Jesus will come out of the heavens and put one foot on the earth and one foot on the sea. And he said, the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of our Lord. And he will rule and reign on this earth as it is told in the Word of God. Friends, one day we're going to have a king that is ruling and reigning, that is one of truth, and one that you can put your trust in. In fact, the Bible says that one day when that happens and the kings, God sets up his kingdom, that there will be one that comes that is carved out of the mountain, a great stone, and the stone shall just come down and just destroy the last Gentile kingdom that exists, and it, that rock will just continue to grow until it becomes a mountain, and then the Lord Jesus Christ will rule and reign on all of the earth. Now, you may not believe He's coming to rule, but He is. And He is coming soon. I'm not going to set a date and say He's going to be here next week or anything else like that, or in December or 2012. I know that some people said now they're trying to set a date called 2012, said He's going to come in 2012. Well, I've heard Him in the past set dates, and He came and went, and He didn't come. But He knows exactly when He's coming. And when that time gets ready, there's no armies, there's nobody going to be able to stop Him from coming to this earth and setting up His kingdom. Now, a lot of people don't believe in a 1,000-year reign upon this earth, but Jesus will rule and reign 1,000 years on this earth. During that reign, there will be peace, real peace. You know, we've had wars and rumors of wars, and that's one of the signs that God gives, that you'll have wars and rumors of wars all the time. But he said, one time He said, when you see all of these things taking place at one time, know that it is near, even at the door. Now, there's a lot of things He told about earthquakes. Have you ever heard of as many earthquakes as we're having today? No, it's just about one or the other. Saw the other day where I believe it was in New York, where a man was driving down the road, and all of a sudden, there was a hole just came in the road. And I think he was in a Cadillac, I'm not sure. And he drove right off in this hole, and he didn't get killed, but somebody had to help him get out, because he got down that hole, and there was a lot of electrical wires and everything that had been pulled loose and everything during this, a lot of water gushing in. He thought he was going to drown, and somebody had to go and help him get out on the side some way or another. He didn't die, and he was not hurt real bad, but some man just happened to be right there close by to help him. If it had been just a little while later, he'd have died down in the hole. Well, you might say, isn't that strange? Well, it's not strange, because God said these going to happen. And I believe some of these weather occurrences that we have, Easter Summit to some of these, whatever they call them, that is awful, and so many people have been killed. And I know some preachers have been criticized by saying that some of these things coming upon this world, one preacher said, it's God's judgment upon the sin that is found in this world. Well, I can't say that it wasn't God's judgment, because God does judge sin. He judged the city of Sodom and Gomorrah when it was so sinful He couldn't even find 10 righteous people. And what God did, he let Lot know that He was going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. And He said, well, you won't destroy it if we can find 10. He said, no. And He just kept on coming down, you know, as to having a number. No, I won't destroy it for that meaning. And finally He couldn't find 10 righteous. And God brought a judgment, a fire and brimstone. And God has told us that our nation and our world will not be destroyed anymore by water. And every time we see the rainbow and realize that God promised us that this world will not be destroyed again by water, because God said it's going to be destroyed by fire. Now, I've been watching these readings and things about something. Some things are taking place in the heavens. And the other day, I forgot which planet it was. It was going to be so close to the sun. You can look at me. You remember what planet it was? What planet it was? And I know this, if God's going to destroy it by fire, you may say, well, you're crazy. Well, I may be a little crazy. But listen, if God wanted to, all you have to do is take that sun and push it down to the earth closer, and what would happen? He could burn up everything on this earth by just pushing the sun down a little closer. And I don't know if that's the way I don't know how He's going to do it. I don't know. I've kind of got an idea of some other things you read in the Bible that it's going to be because of some kind of atomic battles or some kind of atomic bombs and things like that. And I read in the scriptures about there was a time when the heat was so terrific that people flesh just melted off of their body, just melted off the body, and there was a skeleton still standing up. It was so fast. Well, that's exactly what the atomic bomb does. It just melts the flesh off of your body. And I'll tell you, the heat is so terrific that man has never known anything like that. Well, I don't really care how God's going to do this, because He says that whenever the great tribulation period happens and all these terrible things are happening, he says that we will be with him in heaven with ringside seats, and we will not have to go through that. Because you have been faithful to me and because you have believed in me, I will keep you from that hour that's going to come upon the whole world to try. We don't have to go through all these great tribulations and all these things. But we know that this is coming. In Genesis 4:16, Cain went out from the presence of the Lord and dwelt in the land of Nod on the east side of Eden. Nod means, live, as I said, the land of wandering. And it implies a traveling from place to place. Tradition is, as I said, he went to great distances of India, China, and other places. The Bible gathers great significance in the light of the word of Jesus to Daniel. Greece was speaking of the end times. Here's what Daniel said. The Lord revealed to him the course of the age, the times of the Gentiles, and what would happen in the end time. It relates to the time of the tribulation with which this age will end, the rise of the Antichrist, and the coming of the King of Kings, when the stone that is cut without hands smites the image of Gentile world dominion and grinds it to powder, while the crushing stone itself becomes a great mountain. And the interpretation is clear, for Daniel sees the coming of the Lord in glory and says in Daniel 7, verses 23 and 24, I saw in the night visions, and beheld one like the Son of Man come with the clouds of heaven, and came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him here before, and there was given him dominion and glory and a kingdom that all people, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed. Daniel understood that the prophecies he saw had to do with the latter days and the coming of Messiah, but again was not allowed to know the exact time. This would remain a secret until his prophecies had come to pass. Only today are we able to understand the things that Daniel inquired about. Until recently, we could not know the meaning of much of the book of Daniel. You know, when Daniel wrote the book of Daniel and got through, he asked God, he said, I don't understand this. He said, don't worry about it. This is not for your day. What I have written is for the end time, for the latter days. He said, shut it up, seal it, and don't worry about it. Because when the time comes, these things will be fulfilled. But just before the setting of the kingdom of God, and that there will be an age of speed. That's what the word of God said. Speed and travel, and knowledge shall be increased. Education. Now, many of us have witnessed the change from the horse and buggy. Any of you old enough in here remember the horse and buggy days? Well, you know, the horse and buggy days already passed away, is it not? I remember even going to church on Sunday in a horse and buggy. Any of you ever go to church on the horse with a horse and buggy? Boy, it was hot. You talk about hot. It was hot. I know I'm older than most of you here, but have you thought about what you have witnessed as an individual in just your lifetime? I can't. When I think back and look at this, I just can't imagine that I have. In my lifetime, the things that I have seen change. When I was a little boy, I remember when we didn't even have electricity. You remember not having electricity? I see a few of you shaking your head, which means that there's a few older people here along with me. But I remember when we didn't even have running water in the house. And we used to go out on the back porch, and they had a place out there in a little pan. And we'd have to draw the water up out of the well, even take a bath. And everybody, you know, they talk about staying clean and sanitized and everything today. I don't know how sanitary that was back that day when everybody came in off the field and washed and everything, their face and their hands in the pan, and everybody washed in the same pan. I guess they all got some clean water, but it was not, I guess, too sanitary. But I remember a lot of these things. But it's during this time that you and I have lived, we have witnessed the coming of the automobile. Now, I remember when I was a young boy, you didn't see many automobiles on the road. Now, many people had an automobile. Maybe those that were rich, considered to be rich, maybe they were able to have automobiles. But can you imagine what a car cost back then? I hear people talking today about buying those automobiles back then. That was less than $1,000. What do you pay for an automobile today? The cheapest, I guess the cheapest automobile you can find around today is got to be around at least $10,000, somewhere around that. And now that pickup trucks, it's everybody's favorite. Everybody likes a pickup truck, right? My wife allowed me one time, she said, I'm going to let you get a toy. You can have a pickup truck. And so I got me a pickup truck, and I tell you what, I love my pickup truck. You remember that old lady that used to advertise pickup trucks? I don't want you to say, I don't want you to go buy an ugly truck. If you remember seeing that advertisement, I did. But we saw the automobile come in pretty well into its existence. Not maybe its existence, but it had just started when we were born. But the airplane, you didn't see a lot of people flying around. But now then, people get on an airplane here, fly overseas somewhere, and eat breakfast, and fly back home maybe and eat dinner. Who'd ever thought that you could travel like that? Well, he said that travel would be increased. Well, the first one that did that was Cain. He went a long way. I could say he went a fur way. Some of you wouldn't understand what fur is, would you? You know, fur is really the same word as far.
Yeah.
A far way. He went a far way into these countries over here. Well, I see it's getting, I hadn't heard any. Well, I just got a sign. That it is getting close to 12 o'clock. But what about today? And now rockets and spaceships orbit the Earth at many times the speed of the Earth's rotation upon its own axis. We have seen today when we have got men to the moon and got them back safely. And I don't know, they still, a lot of people still don't believe that man ever stepped on the moon. I lived next to a black lady up there in Pima when I lived up there, and she was an older lady, and we'd come out the backyard there, and we had some trees and everything that had some. I forgot what kind of trees they were. What? Pecans. And I'd go out there and crack pecans out in the yard. She'd come out and we'd talk about it. And she'd tell me, said, they're pulling a big farce on the American people. There is no way that God is going to let a man step on the moon. Well, I actually believe they did step out on the moon, don't you? And I believe that they got them back. Now, that's a great accomplishment, but that's been in our lifetime. You know, we were able to witness for the first time somebody go a distance like that to the moon and get out on and walk on the moon's surface and get back into whatever they was traveling in and come back to the Earth safe. Of course, they've lost several people in trying to do this. But man has become a traveler. In our childhood days, most of us seldom traveled more than a few miles from home, usually by foot, horse, or train. Anyone who had traveled abroad was in the upper strata. Those who traveled far in California for pleasure were the envy of all today. All of this has changed with the advent of the automobile. We travel further from home than our fathers did in a lifetime. You know, one of the writers said that going to and fro, to and fro. Man is just always on the go. You know, we're going down to Bell. We just were there yesterday, but we're going back today. How many of you would agree that you travel further now to eat a meal than your families ever traveled their lifetime? Who ever thought you'd go all the way to Snead to eat a meal? Or you'd go to Anniston or Gadsden or Brooklyn? Who thought you'd drive to Birmingham to eat a meal? And you go down there and you find the same thing there that they got in Gadsden. But yet, we like to travel. Well, that's what the Bible said in the end times, that men will be running to and fro, traveling great distance, and that's the first mention. Well, would you agree with me then that the Bible is right when it said, you go back and study the days of Noah before the flood, and what were they doing? Well, they were just carrying on their everyday duties, not even conscious of the fact that Christ could come. And Noah had preached for all these years, telling them that God was fixing to destroy the earth with a flood. Well, they didn't really care because they didn't know what water was. They didn't know what a flood was. So they just didn't believe the word of God. Didn't believe God. And so they were just carrying on their ordinary duties of marriage, giving your marriage. And I tell you, it's just so common today about giving your marriage and So many families that have children, they're anxious to get rid of the children. They're trying to get them married off, and then when they come back home with all their kids and everything, you wish you hadn't got them married off. But this is the days that we're living in. That Jesus said, this is where to be when I come. Now, how in the world then can we say that Jesus coming is not time? Joy, you taking care of the invitation?
Yeah.
We're going to have sing an invitation, and let me just make this invitation to you, that if you don't know today, that if you die today, if you don't have the assurance in your heart that you know you'd go to heaven, then you need to get that assurance. It's the greatest assurance that you can have, to know that I'm okay. If something happens to me and I die, I know that I will wake up in heaven. Because the Bible teaches us that to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord if we are Christians. But it also said over there in Luke that if you die as a sinner like the rich man did, that he woke up in hell being in torments in these flames. And a lot of people don't believe there's flames in hell. But friends, the Bible says it is. And this man who went there spoke back to us and said, it's hot down here. And he got concerned about his brothers and said, I wish somebody would just go back and preach to my brothers. I don't want them to come down here. But you know what, friends? There's a lot of people here who've never had nobody tell them that they need to escape hell. But there is a hell. And there is a heaven. And Jesus is the one who said, I said before you, death and life. Won't you just choose life that you might have eternal life? That you just come to me? Let's stand and we'll sing a verse of our invitation. And if you have a need, I want you to come. Or if you feel like that you might want to be a member of the church, this fellowship, we invite you to come and just make it known. And we certainly would like for you to do that. But whatever God wants you to do, you just do what you feel like the Lord wants you to do.
Page 351, and let's sing the first and second verse.